Our Frederick Pleitgen is in a key location over the border from Ukraine and Russia. Fred, tell us what you're seeing.
Hi there, John. Yeah, those streaks that you're seeing up there in the sky, I don't know how we can see exactly right now. You can see more artillery rockets apparently be firing from Russian territory towards the territory, I would say, around Kharkiv. I don't know if you can hear this right now. Just gonna not talk for a second. So that's another salvo of what we believe is multiple artillery rocket launchers that have been going off here, say the second or third salvo that we saw down here. I just want to explain really quick where I am actually, John, because I'm at the last checkpoint before the front line near Kharkiv. I'm on the Russian side. I'm south of the town of Belgorod. And what you see behind me over there, that's the sort of last checkpoint. And in that direction over there, that's where Kharkiv would be, where we had Sam Kiley before. So what we've been seeing here over the past couple of minutes, over the past really 45 minutes since we've been here, there's more rockets that's being fired right now. If we look in the sky, we can see it there. If we pan up, there's another salvo being fired right now. So you can see in this area, the Russians firing artillery rockets towards Ukraine.
Fred, I do think we see some equipment behind you rolling. In general, look at this if you can.
Yeah. Hey, John, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, there's a column of main battle tanks that are coming to here. I'd say it's some sort of model of the T-72. You can tell they're rolling past. I'm going to have to speak very loud because they are obviously very loud as they roll along here. They're rolling past our position right now. And what you can see here is that their tracks are very dirty. So they must have been dug into some field and now sort of switching their positions. They're coming past us right now. And this is really something. We can get close. You can see that their tracks are really covered in mud. So they must have been sort of dug into some sort of field position as they're rolling past us now. And now if we pan over, you can see that those vehicles also, John, are now moving forward. Those vehicles are clearly now moving forward towards the territory of Ukraine. They've come from somewhere on the side. They've just made that turn, and that's exactly the road leading to Ukraine. So that certainly to us appears as though right now what we're seeing right here is parts of the Russian military moving further into Ukraine, moving their hardware into Ukraine. So this really seems to be the Russians now, or at least some of their tanks, going from right here to then move towards Ukrainian territory, certainly advancing closer towards Kharkiv, where our own Sam Kiley is. So that's something that we've seen sort of similar throughout the time that we've been here. But these main battle tanks, obviously, right now, that is an ominous sign that the Russians certainly are moving some pretty heavy armor towards Ukrainian territory, if not directly into Ukraine, John.
So Fred Pleitgen, again, over the Russian border here near Belgorod, literally seeing tanks rolling in to Ukraine. And let's go now to our Sam Kiley, who is in Kharkiv. Sam, we saw firing from the Russian side at Fred Pleitgen's location. What did you hear in Kharkiv?
I'm pretty sure we heard the incoming, not into the city, I have to say. But strangely enough, I was stood against the window of my hotel room and could feel the concussion against the glass. Now, that does not happen unless you're very close to something that's going out. So there was definitely significant incoming that timed pretty closely to what Fred was showing us live on CNN there, with the outgoing salvos coming from the Russian missiles and artillery into locations in or around Kharkiv. They've been hitting not downtown Kharkiv where I am, but they have been hitting the periphery. A block of flats, of apartments, was struck. We know. We also know that military installations here have been struck. But if what Fred is seeing now, and I've been up that road just about 10 days ago, it's a direct road pretty much due north from here. It's only 25 miles to the border crossing, and even a tank moving across the landscape there would move fairly slowly, but coming down the main road would be able to move pretty fast. So there will be an anticipation. I think that the Ukrainian military may try to stop them. This will not be a move that would come as a great surprise to the Ukrainian military. The real issue is, what do they have to block its path? Or even if they're going, are they going to bother, or are they going to melt away and try to run some kind of counterinsurgency, I should say, rather than counterinsurgency, forcing the Russians into fighting what would, in the later days and months, weeks, may turn into a counterinsurgency.
Sam, Fred, stand by for a minute, if you will, and just again to give people a sense on this map. Fred is up here in Belgorod, Sam in Kharkiv, just over the border there, not a large distance separating them. General Mark Hertling is with us. We saw in Fred's shot, and we can get these all guys back up again, we saw the beginning of a column of tanks moving from Russia into Ukraine. Sam speculating that maybe the Ukrainian military will try to stop them. How? How would they?
What you're seeing, John, it, very unlike desert warfare where the defender has no place to hide, there are forests and undulating terrain throughout northern Ukraine. So what you're talking about is this is perfect counter or anti-armor territory. This is where the javelins will have effect because soldiers firing those javelins, which have about a 3,000-meter range, are going to be able to hide in woodlands. They're going to be able to hide behind hill masses when they see those tanks go past on the road. What the Russian way of war is you keep those tanks, we call it nose to butt. They're literally about 10 meters apart when they're traveling down the road, but when they get into their final attack positions, they spread out over the ground. So they can move quickly on the roads, but then they go into the terrain and start attempting to maneuver on anything that's firing back at them. These kind of positions that could be there with Javelin anti-tank missiles will certainly affect those. Now you see some more rockets going off, but that's all the prep of the battlefield. Because those rockets are traveling, like I said, 50 miles, those tanks won't get to the area where those rockets are landing for at least 2 hours. So you're talking about a very slow movement. Now what you're seeing is an artillery piece on the screen, very different from a tank. That's the thing that has the range of about 20 miles, give or take. And those are the things that travel along with the tanks that provide close-in artillery fire.
General Fred, Sam, don't go far. Stand by. Please pipe up if you see any more developments. In the meantime, I do want to bring in Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster, former U.S. National Security Advisor and author of the book Battlegrounds. General, I do appreciate you being with us. We have these breaking developments happening before our very eyes. Tanks rolling past our reporter in Russia into Ukraine. What do you make of that this morning, General?
Well, John, it's not going to be over soon, right? We are already, you know, in the middle of a war that began in 2014, and it's actually a long campaign over 20 years that Putin has been launching to restore Russia to national greatness and to mainly do that by dragging everybody else down, disrupting countries in the former territories of the Soviet Union, the former Warsaw Pact with a massive attack like this, but massive cyber attacks. Remember the invasion of Georgia in 2008. And we're going to see more and more of this until we're able to impose costs on Putin beyond those that he factors in at the beginning of this decision-making process now to renew the invasion of Ukraine.